in the name of Christ. Of course, we are glad that those on live stream are with us. We greet you also. Pray that it is well with you. Tonight we're going to be in the fourth chapter of John. This will be our 43rd exposition of this book. We're going to be in verses 7 through 10. Part of a rather lengthy section that has Jesus speaking with the woman, the Samaritan woman. Now, as you know or may not know, the gospel is the foundation of the record God has given of his son. It has three pillars: the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Yes. That's not the total gospel. That's the pillars that hold up the gospel. The record God has given of his son is a full account of Christ's tenure in the world. The record God has given of his son, God tells you what it is, actually. He gives us the sum of it, It's his first John 5:11. And this is the record. So there. So now he's going to give you the total. Yeah. See, he's not gonna deal with all the things in the column, deal with the total. This is the record that God has given us eternal life. Yeah. And this life is in his son. Right? So it's a borrowed life.
Yeah.
You have eternal life, but it's borrowed in Christ. The record is not that we can have eternal life. I want to make this clear. We're talking now about the message to God's people. We're not talking about the message to the world. God speaks differently to his people. He tells them what they have.
Yes.
He tells the world what they can have. See that? You see, well, it's the same thing. Well, but it's what you have is more fully stated than what you can have.
That's right.
God has given us eternal life. That's a testimony. Now, this is a record that's to those that are in Christ Jesus. This is you have.
Yes.
Been given eternal life. That's the record. And John was concerned that the people of God know this, and a lot of God's people don't know this. I mean, they know that in the creedal form, they know it. Some may not even know it in the creedal form, but John said in 1 John 5:13, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life."
Yes.
"And that you may believe on the name of the Son of God." That's omitted from later versions, but I accept it as legitimate. In other words, when you know you have eternal life, then you can believe as you are. God intends for you to believe.
Amen.
Otherwise, it's very difficult to believe.
Yes.
Not impossible. I understand, not impossible. But when you know you have eternal life, it's believing is more doable. Now, Jesus himself defined eternal life. It's not like endless existence. That's not what we're talking about, because Satan has that. The damned have that. Satan's angels have that.
Yes.
Principalities and powers, we wrestle against, they have that. So endless existence, that's not what eternal life is.
Amen.
But eternal life is what Jesus defined. He says this, and he defined in a prayer to God. So this would be the most precise definition you can get.
Amen.
Jesus isn't talking to his disciples, he's talking to his Father. So this is the sum of. This is a compressed sum of what eternal life is. That they might know thee, the only true God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. Not know about you. That, they might know that you'd be acquainted with. Remember in Job there says, acquaint now thyself with the Almighty and be at peace. You're acquainted with God. Let's put it another way. You're able to recognize God.
Yeah.
When God works, you're able to see it and know who did it. And Jesus Christ. And John, he corroborates that in 1 John 5:20. He says that we know that the Son of God is, not has, is come. What's the difference between is come and has come? His come means he came and he's staying.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
We know the Son of God is come and has given us an understanding that we might know him that is true, and we are in him that is true. This is eternal life. That's 1 John 5:20. See, so this is precisely defined. Now, knowing you have eternal life, and if you don't know it, don't pretend like you do. God will help you in this area, but you got to acknowledge, if you don't know, you just got to say you don't know.
That's right.
That's all there is, and God will help you to know it. Because when you know it, then's when assurance and confidence and hope blossom.
Amen. Yes.
See, the reason people don't have a hope, or they don't have confidence, or they don't have assurance, is because they don't know they have eternal life. That's what the what the bottleneck is. So John, he knows, he's writing so you know this, because everything's going to spring out, all the practicality of spiritual life all springs forth from knowing you have eternal life, which is by faith, see?
That's right,
So if a person's deficient in faith, and they don't know they have eternal life, this becomes a bottleneck. This is like a strangulation.
That's right. Yeah.
You can't proceed any further till that thing is settled.
Amen.
Now, what our text is going to show us tonight is the willingness of Jesus to bestow this eternal life.
Yes.
No one had to talk Jesus into doing this. He's willing. It's going to be demonstrated. Our text is John 4, 7 through 10. Jesus has left Judea after there's an argument arose about baptism, John's baptism and his. They'd heard that he was baptized and more disciples than John, and it created an environment Jesus didn't want to stay.
Yeah.
So he left. Came to Samaria, was going to Galilee, and he had to go through Samaria, the middle region of the Promised Land. And he's sitting on Jacob's well. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. See, they'd have drawn it if they were there. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest a drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith unto thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water.
Amen.
Boy. That's a great, great text.
Amen.
Now, as a background to this incident, it's important to brush up our recollection of the nature of Christ's ministry. When Jesus was here, he wasn't just a freelancer.
That's right.
Just moved about and did what he thought best to do. That isn't what he did, even though if any man could have done that, I suppose Jesus could have done it, but that's not what he did.
Right.
He told us about this. He said, John 12:49, I have not spoken of myself. That is, I didn't think this out and decide what I should say. But the Father was sent me, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. When it came to doing, he said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself." I can't operate independent of my Father.
Amen.
This is Jesus now we're talking about. We're not talking about us who do try and do this, live independent from God. This is like a plague in a human race. I can do nothing of himself, but when he seeth the Father do, what he seeth the Father do, for what things soever he doeth, these doeth the Son likewise. So Jesus, he lived out the doctrine that we're taught. We're taught, yield yourselves unto God. As those who are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. That's Romans 6:13. All right, that Jesus was doing that.
That's right.
This is what Jesus did.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus did what we're told to do.
Amen.
He said, "I won't do it. If the Father's not doing this, I won't do it. Mm-hmm. I only do what the Father told me to do and what he shows me he's doing. That's the only thing I do." Now, this being true, then this incident we just read about, Jesus was where God wanted him.
Amen.
This woman is who God wanted to come.
Yes.
The disciples being away is what God purposed.
Mm-hmm.
The message delivered to this woman is what God determined. God had determined, I'm going to draw this woman to my Son.
Yes. That's right.
Yeah. It's good to be able to put this all,
yeah.
put this together. See, the truth of the matter is, Jesus told, I have other sheep,
mm-hmm.
other than the Jews. I have other sheep. He came to the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
That was his focus when he was here. He came to his own.
That's right.
That's who he came to.
Mm-hmm.
But he said, I have some other sheep that aren't of this fold.
Yeah.
This woman is one of those
Amen.
Other sheep. It's time for some of these other sheep to hear.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
God determined it. This isn't determined by man. You don't determine who's going to hear.
Amen.
I mean, effectively hear.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Brother Jason.
It's just an interesting thing that most of the time Jesus' interactions with individuals were positive.
Yeah.
His interactions with the crowds were negative.
Yeah.
It's just interesting.
Yes, it is.
Because
Amen.
The emphasis in Christianity is almost always on how big of a crowd you can get.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. Very good observation. Now, this occasion we're reading about, this is not happenstance or coincidence or randomness. The king in heaven
yes.
has arranged this. Now, if you could see behind the scenes, you would have seen a ladder set up on earth with angels
yeah.
coming and going, arranging this circumstance as a context in which Jesus can work. See, Jesus doesn't work in just any context.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Amen. There are some places he won't go. There are some people he won't open the truth to.
Mm-hmm.
This, I don't know who they are, but the scriptures tell us that this is the case.
Yes.
And so this context, I don't doubt that heavenly messengers had set all this up.
Yeah.
So Jesus was where the Father wanted him to be at the time he wanted to be there to meet someone God intended for him to meet. He is going to gather some first fruits right here in Samaria. He's going to gather some first fruits. This wasn't the ordinary place where he'd be found. See, any other time you wouldn't find Jesus in Samaria. In fact, when he sent his 12 out the first time, he said, don't go to any city in Samaria. Don't do it. You say, well, how come he did? Because his Father orchestrated this, was to be done. Now when the gospel is preached in Samaria after Jesus goes back to glory, there will have been some spade work done already. Because when Philip went down there, they believed right off the bat. They heard his sermon and the whole city believed. Well, why?
Yes, amen.
There's a woman here. She was the seed for that. There cometh a woman of Samaria. Chronologically, this is the first mention of Samaria or a Samaritan following the birth of Christ. To be more exact, since the writing of Micah the prophet, the Samaritans had never been mentioned. Or Samaria. Samaria and the Samaritans had not been mentioned since Micah, which was around 700 years prior. I'm showing that you can only account for this by the fact that God is working in this. Even during Jesus' ministry, as I said, he sent out the 12. He said, go not into the way of the Gentiles and into any city of the Samaritans. Enter ye not. Don't go into any city of the Samaritans. Why? Wasn't time. Wasn't time. Some may mistakenly assume that the Samaritans were written off, but we're going to say, no, they weren't. They weren't written off, but it was with the Samaritans like it was with Israel. Some were broken off, but not all.
That's
see,
right.
This woman was one that wasn't. And you remember the time when Jesus was going up to Galilee, went through Samaria, and they wouldn't receive him. So this incident, when he told him, don't go into any of the cities of the Samaritans. This was to them like Asia and Bithynia was to Paul.
Yeah.
Paul and his group that was with him, they essayed or attempted to go into Asia, and the Holy Spirit wouldn't let him go there. How? I think he just blocked the way to go there. Because some people, when they're blocked, they try and barge in anyway.
Yeah.
They, you know what the Spirit said, no, you can't go. So they tried to go into Bithynia, and the Holy Spirit wouldn't allow that either. Mm-hmm. Well, later, Asia and Bithynia both heard, but it wasn't the time. There's a time when people are to hear, and you don't know when it is, and I don't. Only as you're directed by God do you know who like do you go to. Some people just throw a dart, you know, and they go there. Or they say, well, here's a nation, they don't believe in the Lord, we're going to go there because they don't believe. This is not what drives gospel preaching. It's not human assessment that drives it. So there's a tremendous amount of wasted effort that's expended. Now, remember in this case here, Jesus was worried with his journey. He's sitting on Jacob's well resting. Now, how will the Father refresh him? You know, the disciples start with some food. That's what would refresh him. Well, the Lord's going to refresh him a different way. He won't send like maybe a dignitary, maybe the mayor of Samaria. There'll be a chance. Then you can reach more people, see? That's not who he sends. Maybe the city fathers. Maybe that's who. No, that's not who he sends. God doesn't work in that manner. He sends a woman, and like it's not the best woman. This isn't one of the chief women of Samaria. This is not an admirable woman.
Yeah.
But that's who God sends to her, to him. She had nothing to commend herself. But she knew what she was. And someone like that, now Jesus can work with somebody like that. So Jesus says to her, four English words, give me a drink. Some texts say, will you give me a drink, or please give me a drink. Jesus had left Judea, which was the main part of the promised land where Jerusalem was. He'd left that area. Now he's in this area that, not the best area. He says, give me something to drink. So he's thirsty. About 3 years later, on a cross, Jesus is going to be thirsty again.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Cried, I thirst, fulfilling the scriptures. Now, let me put to you this. Who is able to measure the degree to which Jesus humbled or lowered himself to experience that kind of need?
Right.
How far down? How far down did Jesus have to come to have to ask for a drink of water? Yeah. He has something to think about.
Amen.
This confirms the depths to which sin had taken humanity.
Mm-hmm.
However far sin took,
yes,
that's how far Jesus had to come.
Amen.
And it was way down there. The moral and spiritual decline of humanity was rapid and unmistakably deep. It was a condition that couldn't be resolved by a creative word like God dispelled that primeval darkness that covered the face of the deep. He just did it with a word. Now you're in an area of morality and this can't be done with a word. So Jesus had to divest himself of all the prerogatives of deity. So he had to save men as a man, not as God. He had to overcome Satan as a man, not as God. See, he had to face death as a man, not as God. And all of that's in this, give me a drink. He wasn't like pretending he was thirsty.
That's right.
He really was. This entire circumstance shows us the condition of the world at which time God's going to work a divine rescue operation.
Really, given it's a note to notice that Jesus asked this woman for something she could do.
He could do, that's right. That's right. And it says his disciples are gone away. That all of the text started here didn't tell you that when Jesus left Judea that his disciples went with him. But now you know that they went with him when he went there. Yes.
Brother's coming. Brother.
Oh, Brother Aaron, sorry.
Jesus didn't work a miracle and make the water come up for him.
That's right. Amen.
He turned water into wine. He was always doing something
for
other
else.
People.
Yeah.
Everybody else benefited from his miracles. He never did work any miracles to relieve his own
good
to create his own comfort.
Amen.
Or anything like that. He said he came to serve, and that's that's what he did.
Very good. Very good. So the disciples who had went with him, they were always with him.
Mm-hmm.
Once, and the 12 hadn't been chosen yet. You keep that in the back of your mind. This was a few of his disciples. The 12 hadn't been chosen yet. They'd gone into the city to buy meat. Their meat in Scripture means food. Now, this was a common experience with which men could identify. We're hungry, we need some food, we're thirsty, we need some water. But that is not what the Holy Spirit accents. He doesn't lay a lot of stress on Jesus was thirsty, he'd been without water for so long, and he'd been without food for so long. He doesn't accent that. He's going to accent the distribution of nourishment instead of the reception of. And this is the truth. You have to be able to see it, but if you will exercise yourself to dispense benefit, you will actually end up receiving more benefit. That's the way the king, give, and it shall be given unto you. See, that's what he said. So he will address now a greater need, the woman. Yes.
I've experienced many times there will be times when you sense the Lord needs to give special attention to a person, but he arranges for certain people to not be there while you do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it creates this liberty because you're not having to deal with immaturity or weaknesses or blind spots of another person while you're speaking to an individual the truth they need to hear. And what's wonderful about that is that oftentimes if someone really, really is a believer, but they aren't necessarily able to join you in the work of coming alongside someone else, if they observe then the fruit of that, something that maybe ordinarily they'd say, no, that's not how things are done, they can see the outcome of it, just like the disciples saw or began to see with what Jesus was doing with this Samaritan woman.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, they're going to behold all of all of this. Well, the Samaritan woman says, "How is it?" She's surprised that he would ask her. How can you ask me for a drink? How can a Jewish man like you ask me for a drink? One version says. The Living Bible says the woman is surprised that a Jew would ask a despised Samaritan for anything. This wasn't the custom. Maybe that's one of the secrets to reaching people, is to stop using customary ways. Something to think about at any rate. See, this woman had learned to live with the rejection of the Jews. She wasn't like bitter. She just adapted to the situation. It's just part of living at that time. For the Jews, because of the depravity of Jeroboam, the captivity of Israel, and the importing of foreigners into the Holy Land, they simply broken off relations with people in Samaria because they were a corrupted people. They didn't even worship the same God or observe the same law or the prophets. Something is going to happen here that will be against prevailing perceptions and manners. This is going to break off from what the normal things were. This is another reason why people have to be familiar with God, acquainted with God, able to tell when God's moving and when he's working. In this case here, God's going to actually intrude into the affairs of men. He's going to intrude into them. I will tell you that it is sheer folly to imagine that an insensitive and imperceptive church will be used by God. You have to really work at substantiating that. If he would, then I don't see really why there's such a thing as eternal life, you know. If we're called into the fellowship of his dear son, anyway, something to think about. Now, there's something else that this woman probably didn't know, but divine rejection, and God does reject some people. Divine rejection has limitations, and God has spoken on this matter. Exodus 20 and verse 5, God is a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. So this is not an unending curse. That tells you something about God. See, there are entire generations now that have been rejected. Jesus ministered to one. There was a remnant in it. There was an entire generation that was just written off. That's it. He said, your house is left desolate. You're not going to see me again till you say, blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Now, that didn't mean some individual that was seeking the Lord wouldn't, but as a generation, that was it. How about Gene?
I spoke from a text today in John or Jeremiah 11. The Lord says, don't pray for these people. I'm not going to listen to them, even if they cry out to me in despair. Yeah. I'll not listen to them.
Yeah, three times, I believe, he said that to Jeremiah. Yes.
You know, when you speak about these generations that have been written off, like even in the worst-case scenario, the case of Noah, where just a man and his family were the only ones, that really gives you an appreciation for the remnant, because, in a sense, they're the reason the world keeps going.
That's exactly it.
Yeah,
this... I'm going to be careful how I say this, but I think we're in a generation like that. I think we're in a generation that has been rejected. There's a remnant, and sometimes there can be considerable people in the remnant. Thousands hadn't bowed the knee to Baal, you know.
That's right.
So there can be a remnant doesn't mean little bitty. It means proportionately.
Yeah.
I don't know how you can account for the moral decay of this generation apart from this.
Yeah.
And I'm careful to say this is my own opinion on the matter. But there are generations like that. But even if you are in a generation like that, that doesn't mean the door is shut to you. Even if it's a year in a generation like that. Yeah, he rejected Jerusalem. There's some people in Jerusalem. There's quite a few people in Jerusalem believed.
That's right. Yeah.
But proportionately, it was few. During the time of Christ, here he's going to reap one. After he's exalted, he's going to tell to preach the gospel and to do it in Samaria. Remember? So he's going to revisit this. But at this point, they were not ready to be reaped. There's also the matter of fields being white under harvest. And this text is the text where that is stated. Mm-hmm. The disciples joined Jesus. They were surprised he's talking to this woman. Mm-hmm. And then in the distance, here comes a battery of people out of Samaria to him. And Jesus looks at that body of people coming to him, and he says, behold, the fields are white already.
Yeah.
A place where unbelief reigns is not necessarily ready to be reaped.
Uh-huh.
It can be preached to, I understand that, but it's not ready to be reaped. There's some places when you go, you're not going to get a lot of people in. Because they're not ready to be reaped. And it's important that people who do that are close enough to God to detect when to go, when to stay, when to leave, all that sort of thing. But this is one of those cases. There was some ripe grain in this desolate area. We're going to find there was a considerable amount of ripe grain. A woman of Samaria. That's a Samaritan woman like me. Now, as I mentioned, Samaria was a part of the Promised Land. It was the middle section of the Promised Land, but it was unlike the rest of the Promised Land. Under the leadership of Jeroboam, idolatry was instituted here. But preceding that, when the Assyrians took Israel captive, and incidentally, Israel has never recovered from the Assyrian captivity. Judah came back from the Babylonian captivity. Israel has never, they're still dispersed to this day. They're still dispersed. And God, several places in the prophets said, I'm going to bring you from the countries I get. Since dispersed you, I'll bring you back. So what had happened when they were, Israel was overcome and dispersed. The king of Assyria, about the people in, there was a remnant of people there. He imported some people into the land that were non-Jews. He imported them from Babylon, from Cutta, from Ava, from Hamath, from Sepharvaim, who were placed in the cities of Samaria instead of the children of Israel, and they possessed Samaria and dwelt in the cities thereof. See, so this is how you got heathen people coming in here. And they intermarried with Jewish people. And they're kind of a half-breed. The Samaritans were kind of a half-breed race. And here's what it says about the result of importing these in. And later we learn when Hezekiah threw a feast, there were some people that escaped from that, being exported from the land. There were some people still there. It was a handful of people, but they intermarried with these people. And now here's the Holy Spirit's commentary on the outcome of this mingling. Howbeit every nation, these different cities were from other different nations. And when these people came in, they kept the God that they had. Every nation made gods of their own, put them in the houses of the high places of the which the Samaritans had made. Every nation, their cities wherein they dwelt. So they feared the Lord and made unto themselves the lowest of them priests, of the high places, which sacrificed for them in the houses of the high places. They feared the Lord and served their own gods, after the manner of the nations whom they carried away from thence. Unto this day they do after the former manners. They fear not God, neither do they do after their statutes, or after their ordinances, or after the law and commandments which the Lord commanded the children of Jacob, whom he named Israel. That was a situation. It was an unacceptable situation. And until God opened the door, you stayed out of that part of the country. Now again, this is my own view. In my opinion, the modern church is like Samaria. When I say the modern church, I don't mean like our church, or I mean as a whole. It's like Samaria. It's got too much mingling in it. There's too much falsity in it. Oh, you can chisel off and say they're not really a church, and they're not really, and you need to whittle it down so maybe you could get a workable number, but that's not the way Jesus looks at things. Whoever wears his name or is held accountable, whether they are in or not, they're held, like the church at Laodicea, like the church at Sardis. Sardis was dead. But they wore Christ's name. And so we'd call it like Christendom. But it bears more similarity to Samaria than to Judea and Galilee. Interesting, isn't it? That with more grace, you got the same kind of thing happened. That happened when there wasn't a lot of grace. And the Jews, she said, the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Now, it was more than prejudice. It wasn't just prejudice. That isn't what we're talking about here. Maybe some of this did turn into needless prejudice, but this, when the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans, it's because of the caliber of people they were. It's understood that the Samaritans accepted the writings of Moses, but not the writings of the prophets. And this is just as a little tidbit of history. Everyone says that it's accurate. Josephus says that Sanballat, of Nehemiah's time, built a temple for the Samaritans in the mountain Gerizim. And Smith's Bible Dictionary says the same thing. So it says that Alexander, that's the great, took Palestine. When he took Palestine, he gave Sanballat, the Persian governor under Darius, permission to build a temple on Mount Gerizim. And that's the place. The temple had been destroyed by this time. But that's the place that this woman's going to mention. We say that this is the place. This mountain is the place. You say Jerusalem is the place. See?
Yeah.
But Jason.
You're mentioning why the Jews didn't go into Samaria. You know, God had told them not to mix with the other nations.
Yes.
And it could be argued that they might have taken that too far, but that was what the law said.
That's right.
To be careful how you mingle with these idolatrous people. So the reason Jesus is going there, this prefigures.
Yeah.
It anticipates the opening of the gospel to the Gentiles.
That's
remember
right.
In the book of Acts,
that's right.
It took them several years
to
catch on to this. And Peter, you know, when he was at Cornelius, he said, I understand now that God accepts men from every nation to do what is right. And it took Peter have that vision and everything. This was hammered into the Jewish people for centuries. But this was this marks like a change of covenants.
Yeah. Amen.
It marks a new era. See, and God's salvation is going to reach out to the nations.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Now that Cornelius, that was 10 years. That was a decade. 10 years after Pentecost, and it hadn't registered with him. But see, God made sure that somebody knew this. And that it made sense. Finally, they had this caucus, you know, and Peter said, look, he says, God sent me there, and God gave them the Holy Spirit, you know, and they turned to God, and then the people said, well, then God gave them repentance. they saw it. They saw that this was legitimate and from God. Why do you, what are you asking me for water? So Jesus, he answered her. He said, if you knew. Now the versions read, if you had knowledge of, or if you recognized, if you'd recognize me. This woman was deficient in knowledge. Knowledge of Christ. She'd not been properly taught. This is what the problem was now. She'd been taught by the Samaritans. They didn't. She did know the Messiah. She knew about a Messiah. She knew about a Christ. That he was going to come and say, he'll tell us all things. Well, that's not exactly a thorough view of things, to say the least. But that's what she was taught. But she wasn't taught right, so she didn't know right.
That's right. Amen.
This kind of condition still exists now, brethren. There are people they don't know. And generally it's because they haven't been taught.
Yeah, that's right.
That's why. God who reveals the true, God is the one who reveals the true identity of Jesus. But he does not do it through a distorted message.
That's right. Amen.
See, God draws people to Jesus. God opens up their understanding to Jesus, but he does not do it through an erroneous gospel.
Yeah, amen.
God is a God of truth, and he doesn't use a lie to promote the truth.
Right.
See, this explains a lot of things that are otherwise rather difficult to. Why don't they know? They've been reading their Bible, they've been going to church. It's because they've been in a context in which God doesn't work.
Yeah, that's right.
Somebody's got to speak that knows what this is all about.
Amen.
Now, when Jesus was here, there were people who recognized him. God revealed the true identity of Jesus, for instance, to Peter. Simeon, when Jesus was an infant, Simeon knew who he was, recognized him. John the Baptist, God showed him who Jesus was. See? Nathanael knew who Jesus was. It is, thou art the Christ. He knew who he was. See, there have been those who have heard Jesus speak, like John 7:31, and they said, this is the Christ. See,
yeah.
It isn't that it was impossible to know. There were some people that knew.
That's right.
Martha knew who he was. She said, I know that thou art the Son of God. She said, I know. What was the difference between those people and this Samaritan woman? They'd been taught properly out of Moses and the prophets. So when they saw someone that fit the description of Moses and the prophets, they knew who it was. Now, listen now, brethren, this is serious stuff.
Yes.
There are some people that have not been told enough about Jesus to recognize him.
Yeah.
They can't tell who the real Christ is.
Amen.
So they associate it with some particular church or some particular creed or some school of thought.
Yes.
But our teaching, anyone's teaching, has to be sufficient so when someone is confronted with Christ, they know that's what they're confronted with.
Yeah. Amen.
The truth of the matter is that some people are very, very deficient in that.
Amen.
In that area.
I can see, Brother Gibbons, that a person needs to be, especially a person that knows the truth, needs to be as patient with other people as God's been with them.
Oh, yes.
And then when you meet someone, they have enough wisdom to be able to determine, are they interested and if they think, you think maybe they're not, maybe they just don't know.
Yeah.
And maybe you can lead them in the right way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, see, this woman divulged enough that you knew that there was some interest there.
Right.
We know that the Christ is going to come and tell us. So this was not the words of a disinterested person. But she'd been drinking from the wrong fountain. See? You can recognize. When you see someone been drinking from the wrong fountain, then give them a drink from the real phone. That's what you do. You don't say, well, you've been drinking from the wrong fountain. What's the matter with you? You give them a drink from the real fountain. As I say, Jesus will not work, God will not work through a distorted message. That ought to be plain enough. If you knew the gift of God, now some of the versions distort this. Some give the right meaning. Here's the basic Bible thing. It's what God gives freely. If Holman Bible says, if you knew God's gift, all right, that's good. God's Word Bible says, if you knew what God's gift is, all right, that. If you knew, it's the New Jerusalem Bible, if you knew what God is offering, that's not proper. If you knew the gift God has for you, that's too loose. If you knew what a wonderful gift God has for you, that's the Living Bible, this is too loose. Weymouth says, if you knew God's free gift, all right, that's pretty good. Williams Bible, if you knew what God has to give, that's too sloppy. Contemporary English Bible, if you knew what God wants to give you. The Message Bible says, if you knew the generosity of God, it's a completely missed the point. The Amplified Bible says, if you recognize God's gift. See, so I ask the question, what is the gift of God? See, that's the question I want to address. What is the gift of God? Now, I'm going to say that the gift of God was Christ. It wasn't what Christ gives, it was Christ. Paul refers to Jesus as the unspeakable gift. 2 Corinthians 9:15. Unspeakable means it's undescribable. It's not expounded in full. Now follow my thinking here. The fullness of the Godhead dwells in Christ, but it's not, it's bigger than you can see. The fullness of God does not dwell in what God gives. Grace is an attribute of God. The fullness of God doesn't dwell in grace. The fullness of God doesn't dwell in eternal life. That's an attribute of God. It's not the fullness of God. The gift is Christ. He's the only one that everything is deposited in him. The fullness of the Godhead dwells in him bodily. He has given to us the one individual that possesses every single thing that God has to give. It's the person that's the gift. Here again, although the woman knew about the coming of the Messiah, she didn't know enough to recognize him. She's looking at him. Right? She sees him. He's sitting right before her, and she didn't know enough to recognize who he was. If you knew the gift of God, you knew. See? Which means the gift of God, Christ, can be known. God, salvation is an economy where people come to know. See, no man knows who Jesus is, who the Son is, but the Father, and he to whom he wills, the Father wills to reveal him. See? And so God is willing to reveal who the Son is, but not to the disinterested, not to those who won't come to him. He won't. Now, I cannot help but make a passing comment here concerning the situation that's developed in what, let us call it, the church world. Some things are known about Jesus, and whatever is true, we thank God for that, but enough is not known about Jesus to take advantage of him. That's why people turn to other things to resolve their problems.
That's right.
They go to some other institution or man or purpose or plan or you name it. Why do they do that? because they don't know the gift of God. Now, that's where the people of God come in. The people of God are not only to declare this, but to live this. Someone said, it was Brother Vernon Smith, made a comment on my Facebook. He said, if you don't love Jesus, don't say you know him. Yeah, it's a good comment. So if you're not living for Christ, please, please, don't tell anyone you're a Christian. You make it difficult for everybody else. See? If you knew the gift of God. So that's a dilemma. That's a dilemma that faces us as people that don't know the gift of God, just like this Samaritan woman. They don't know the gift of God. They don't know what Jesus, who Jesus is and what he possesses and what he can do. They don't know. So they'll go to somebody else whom they think can help them out. I don't know who it is. Now, Jesus said, if you knew the gift of God, if you were able to recognize me, you would have asked me.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. So why don't people ask Jesus for things they're asking everybody else for? Why? They don't know him. I know it's hard to say this about some people. We like by default to think that everyone who says they're a Christian really a Christian and so forth. But listen, if they're going someplace else to obtain the resources, it's because, like it or not, they don't know Christ. So that's your objective.
Yeah, that's right.
Your objective is to enable them to know Christ so they'll go to the right person. He said, if you knew who you were talking to, you'd have asked him. She would have known that the deep thirst she had, here's someone that can meet her. Here's someone that can meet her. The Samaritan people, Samaritan religion, taught people that there was a Christ coming who would tell them all things. All things about what? See, that's about as ambiguous as you can get. Huh? That's what they were taught. He's going to come, he's going to tell us all things. What does that mean? Who knows what that means? Nobody knows what that means. Tell us all things. Nothing about what he'd do. He didn't say anything about what he was going to do or what he was going to proclaim. Remember, he stood up at his hometown synagogue and he announced what he came to do.
That's right.
See, that's not what the Samaritans weren't teaching. They weren't teaching that kind of thing. So she wasn't looking for a Savior that would do something or that would possess something. She's looking for a Christ that would give him some information. All things. People today are almost unaware of things that are within the scope of God's will they can ask for. Now, John said, this is the confidence we have now. If we ask anything according to his will, we know he hears us. And if we know he hears us, we will have the petitions that we requested. That's 1 John 5:14. That's knowing the gift. Well, when you know the gift, see, you can do something like this. Well, Jesus, what would you have done? I mean, this is a Samaritan woman. She doesn't know a whole lot. In fact, comparatively very little. What would Jesus do if she asked? That's all he said, if you would ask. What would Jesus do if she asked? He said he would have given thee living water.
That's right.
For what? For asking.
Yeah, amen.
Just for asking.
Uh-huh.
Not for doing, not for meeting the code, not for measuring up, just asking.
Yeah.
If you knew who I was, you would have asked me and I would have given you.
That's right. Amen.
Living water.
Yeah.
What's living water? Again, the various virgins garble this up. The Geneva Bible says water of life. Contemporary English version says water that gives life, life-giving water, Good News Bible. That's not what he means. Living water is water from a spring as compared to from a river that picks up all the muck and mire as it flows along. It's fresh water, springing up water that has vivifying power to it. Jesus described it as a well within springing up. Springing up into life everlasting, see? Jesus was telling, I'd put that well in you.
Yeah.
Just for the asking. Mm-hmm. That's what I'd do. And don't you see that this is needed, brethren?
Yes, amen.
There's too much dry and moldy bread. In the churches, like the Gibeonites. See, they had to make it look like they'd been coming a long distance. They had dry and moldy bread. And listen, brethren, there are some people that are being served up dry and moldy bread.
Yeah.
I'm just as discontent with it as anybody else is, but I'm saying that that's a situation. Somebody needs to serve up some living water.
Yeah, amen.
No reason why it can't be you.
Mm-hmm.
No reason at all.
That's right.
Too much lifeless and vain tradition, as Peter called it.
Amen.
The existence of such things as this is owing to the hindrance found in the woman of Samaria. There has not been proper teaching. Now, you can't get away from this.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's right.
God put teachers in the church.
Yeah.
Right? 1 Corinthians 12:18 says they rank number 3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Apostles, first apostles, secondarily prophets, mm-hmm. thirdly teachers, and after that, miracles and etc.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they rank high in the church. Why? Because God wants his people to know what he's given.
Amen.
And to know what Christ is about. Christ isn't like an emergency backup. Some people, they know to pray when they don't have food.
Uh-huh.
All right, they know to pray. They have a serious ailment. Someone in their family has a serious ailment. They know to pray, that kind of condition. But what about thirsty souls?
Yeah, yeah.
Do they know how to pray? Mm-hmm. Do they know how to ask? Mm-hmm. Our preaching and teaching and testifying and witnessing should leave people knowing who to ask.
Yes, amen.
And how to inquire, what you should try and find out.
Uh-huh.
So what I want to know is how can I have a successful marriage? Well, you can have a successful marriage, maybe.
Because
Jesus said he was going to divide some homes, too.
Yeah.
I don't want to forget that. Is that what he said?
Yeah.
Yes. Right. He's going to set a man at variance against those of his own house. That's what he said. But he came to bring unity between the person and Christ. That's why we, those of you that are young and unmarried, be very particular about who you marry.
Amen.
Amen.
Remember the Samaritans.
Right.
Just remember the Samaritans.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Be careful about who you marry.
Yeah.
Amen.
Now, if anyone's going to be recovered, going to be taught right. Taught right means you can recognize Christ,
mm-hmm.
and you can make sense out of what you should do to resolve difficulties.
Mm-hmm.
This is going to be resolved by preaching.
Yeah, right.
The foolishness of preaching.
Amen.
God has ordained through the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
Yeah.
Not them that don't believe, them that believe.
Yes.
See?
Amen.
Preaching is proclamation. It's an announcement. It's a report of something that is, not something that should be.
Right.
We don't preach what should be.
Uh-huh.
That's not the gospel message.
Right.
If we preach what should be, it's because there's some kind of defect
mm-hmm.
existent. But the gospel consists of what is.
Yeah.
So I encourage you to help to resolve this situation of spiritual ignorance. Any of you have a word before we close? But my part, yes.
I was thinking about this. Give me a drink. Give me to drink.
Yeah.
And so I thought about, you know, the Lord wanted to be refreshed. And so I thought, well, why did he ask this woman? And he was wearied when he sat down there. And we know he had just left out from the Pharisees and all. And he had departed.
Yeah.
And so he needed some refreshment. So this woman gave him refreshment.
Yes, yes,
yes. I know we hadn't got on into there, but
yes,
she gave him
right.
refreshment. So
yeah.
you know, it was like an encouragement to him for why he was here.
Yeah.
You know,
that's
it
right.
was like a almost like a first fruit.
That's
you know?
Right. It was uh-huh. he was refreshed by pouring.
Yeah.
That's
yes.
right. Yes.
Pouring out.
Amen.
That's right. You will be too.
Yes.
Ever you found it to be so? You're refreshed when you pour out of his belly, not into his belly, out of his belly, shall flow rivers of living water. Yeah, Brother Jason.
There's an interesting parallel here concerning this living water. There's a word from Jeremiah the prophet. He said that God said through him about the people, he says, they have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed out cisterns for themselves, broken cisterns that can hold
no
water.
That's it. That's it.
That's pretty telling, isn't it?
It sure is. Fountain of fountains.
Amen.
Hanging up. Anyone else tonight?
Only Jesus can have this conversation with this kind. No, we would be jumping to conclusions. If we stopped by a well and said, give me a drink, and Nate, so we don't, but Jesus knows her.
That's right.
Jesus knows all about her.
Yeah.
And so he's not jumping to conclusion. He's telling her the things that she's got to hear.
That's right. She took the bowl and ran.
That's right.
You did. All right, Sister Barb.
Whenever Jesus said, if you would have known, then you would have asked. I saw that later in this same conversation, that's going to be the case.
Yes.
Whenever her eyes were beginning to open a little bit, she did ask something.
Mm-hmm.
She was beginning to recognize that this man had some authority.
That's right.
So she was going to ask him something that she wanted to know. Now, we remember that her request was a little bit of a lower nature.
Yeah.
And so continuing that thought, the more we become acquainted with Christ, the more our requests will be fitting of the one we're asking.
Good.
Amen. Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And he gently led her, see?
Yes.
He gently led her.
Right.
All right, Sister Barb.